Hello everyone. So far, I have discussed the definition, motivation, and examples of the vector spaces. In today's class, I am going to explore some fundamental questions related to the vector space. Our next part of this course will be based on same significant questions related to the vector space. So let us talk about the fundamental questions. So I'm going to talk about the fundamental questions . So first fundamental question is this. So I'm going to talk about first question. When is a subset of a vector space itself a vector space? So this is the one of the most important question. The main idea behind this question that I have some vector space. Now we are going to see the some subset of that vector space, and we are going to verify that that particular subset will satisfy same property as vector space or not. So in some case it is true, some case it may not be true. Due to that reason, some new definition comes into picture, and this new definition or this new notion is the notion of the subspace. So from here one new notion comes into picture. So I'm going to write this. So from here notion of sub spaces comes into picture, and in the further part of course we are going to see the formal definitions of subspace and also several examples related to the subspace. For time being, let us come to the second question, and our second question is like this. So move to the second question. So question 2, given a collection of vectors is there a way to tell whether they are independent or if one is linear combination of the others. So we have already seen that in vector space we have infinite many vectors. So suppose that I have collected the some set of vectors, and now we are going to see that these vectors are independent or not. What is meaning of independence here? That is decided by the linear combination. It means that if I select any individual vector, if that is expressed as the remaining vectors, then we are telling that these whole collections are not independent. And this important question finally gives a very good insight, and you can see the definition, that is definition of linear dependence. And similarly we are going to talk about, that is not linear dependence or independent. Let us move to the third question. So our third question is the following. Is there a consistent definition of how big a vector space is? So now we have some space. Inside a space I have vectors, I have field, and I have defined two operation. Now we are going to look through some definition, that what is size of that vector space. And this important question finally gives us the definition of dimension. Now let us move to the final question, that is the fourth question is this: how do we label vectors? Because in one space I have infinite many vectors, so this question is very, very relevant. That is related to the labeling of vector. Or in another way, I can write like this: can we write any vector or vectors as a sum of some basic set of vectors after that? One more important question inside this is like this: how do we change our point of view from vector labeled one way to vector labeled in another way? So basically, if I have a vector space, then there exists a multiple possibility to label the vector. And whenever there exists a multiple possibility, then there exists some kind of relation between one label to another label. So we are also going to explore that kind of point in the further part of this course. And this particular question gives the idea of basis, and basis is the one of the most important object inside the vector space. So again, in the next part of this course, we are going to give lot of visualization about the basis. So what we have seen till now, that I have four fundamental questions. So I have vector space. So we are talking about the subset of vector space, and we are lined up to the one classification and in order to represent that classification we need some new definitions. Similarly, I am talking about this sum collection of vector and we are going to see the dependency of one vector on the another one. And third one is related to the size of vector space and final one is the labeling of vector space. So I am going to discuss the four different questions using 2 and 3 more lectures. So let us first start with the first question that is related to the subspace. So now I am going to discuss about the subspace. So our today class is totally focused on the subspaces of vector space. So before coming to the formal definition of the subspace, let us try to look the motivation. So start with the usual three-dimensional space in R3. So I am going to draw that space like this. So I have three-dimensional space. So I'm going to denote using three component. Suppose this is x1, this is x2, and this is x3. So any point in this space is represented by some kind of column vector and p. So and we are denoting like this. So I have three-dimensional space. We have already seen that if I have vector like this x1, x2 and x3, and where each component x1 and x2 and x3 belongs to some kind of real number, then this will satisfy the all properties of the vector space. And in that space, our operation, that is vector addition and scalar multiplication, is defined in the same way like the addition and multiplication of the real numbers. Now I am going to choose a plane through the origin. So this is my origin. So I am going to denote this origin by different color. So suppose this origin is 0, 0, 0. And I am going to denote by transpose. And so draw this plane. So suppose my plane is like this. So I am going to draw something, some plane that looks like this. So this is my plane in three-dimensional space. So this plane is again a vector space in its own right. What does it mean? If we add two vectors in this plane, you can take any two vectors. So I'm going to use different color to show two vectors. So suppose I have one vector like this in this plane and another vector like this, and if I add these two vectors, so this is the resultant vector. So this is v1 and this is v2, and this particular v equal to v1 plus v2. You can see that their sum is in the same plane. Again, if you multiply this vector with some number, suppose I will take number 2, or even if I will take number -5, means some negative number, whatever resultant vector, that again going to live in the same plane. So again, a plane in three-dimensional space is not R2, even if it looks like R2. The vectors have three components and they belong to R3. So the plane is a vector space inside R3. So whatever plane I am taking, so the plane is a vector space inside R3. So please do not confuse that this plane is in R2. So this particular example illustrates one of the most fundamental ideas in linear algebra. The plane going through 0, 0, 0 is a subspace of the full vector space R3. So now let us come to the formal definition, that how to check something is subspace or not. So I'm going to write the definition of subspace A subspace of a vector space is a set of vectors including 0. So 0, we have already seen that in the different space, we are defining 0 in different way. in case of column space, my 0 is just a column vector. In case of matrix, I have 0 matrix. In case of function space, we have some kind of 0 function. So a subspace of a vector space is a set of vectors including 0, because this is very, very important. If 0 is not included, then we are going to show in the next part of this course that will not satisfy the property of subspace. And I think this is obvious that satisfies to requirements and I'm going to write the requirement. If V and W are vectors in the subspace and C is any scalar, then first requirement is V plus omega is in the subspace, and second one is CV is in the subspace. So this is the one of the definition of the subspace. One can also rewrite the definition like this. So I'm going to talk about another definition. So again, of the same thing, subspace. So definition is like this. Let V be a vector space over the field F. So we have already seen that whenever we are talking about any vector space that is a composite object that contain vectors, field, and two operations. So a subspace of V is a subset W of V which is itself a vector space F with the operation, and whatever operation I am going to consider in that subspace, that is same like vector space of vector addition and a scalar multiplication on V. So this is little more mathematical definition, but first definition as well as second definition both are conveying the same thing, but first definition also gives us one of the way to check that whatever given space inside some vector space, that will satisfy the property of vector space or not. But whatever definition, second definition, that is little bit more generalized. So if one will follow the second definition, then again in order to check something is vector space or not, they have to follow one more theorem. So I am going to state that theorem for sake of completeness. So in order to check something as a subspace, this theorem is very, very important. And after stating the theorem, I will tell you that how basically these two definitions are equivalent. So a non-empty subset W of V is a subspace of V if and only if for each pair of vectors alpha beta in W and each a scalar C in field F, the vector C alpha plus beta is again in W. So using this theorem, it is very easy to check that something satisfies the property of subspace or not. Why I have introduced this theorem? Because parallelly, what I want that you try to understand that how to prove or how to state some theorem. So that is also another goal. So first let us try to see the proof. You can see that here if and only if condition is involved. So what does it mean? That if something satisfies the property of subspace, then they will also satisfy this condition, means C alpha plus beta is again in W or vice versa. So if one will show that C alpha plus beta is in subspace W, where alpha and beta in W and C is the scalar, then it is possible to show that W is a subspace. So let us try to see the proof. Proof is very simple. So let us try to see the proof. So proof is like this. Suppose that W is a non-empty subset of V such that C alpha plus beta belongs to W for all vectors alpha beta in W and for all a scalar C in field F. Now, since W is non-empty set, it means that W has at least one element. There is a vector called rho in W. So here I'm going to denote this as a W. And hence minus 1 rho plus rho equal to 0 is in W. Then if alpha is any vector w and c any scalar the vector c alpha equal to c alpha plus 0. So previous statement tells us that there exists some 0, and next statement give guarantee that if I add 0 to some element, then that is not going to alter is in W in particular alpha is in W. So finally, if alpha and beta are in W, then alpha plus beta can be represented like this: 1 alpha and beta, that is again is in W. So here you can see that C equal to 1. Thus W is a subspace of V. Now conversely, I have to show. So because condition is if and only if W is a subspace of V, alpha and beta are in W and C is a scalar, certainly C alpha plus beta is in W. So basically, whatever first definition we have seen, that is somehow use the property of this particular theorem. So I'm going to write the remark. So remark is like this. Some people prefer to use the alpha plus beta property in theorem, above theorem, as the definition of a subspace. So what we have seen, that I have two different definitions, and in first definition I have to check these two requirement, and somehow whatever theorem I have stated, that is going to combine both requirement together. So most of time it is pretty easy to check that something is subspace or not using the theorem, whatever theorem I have stated here. So due to that reason, I have, in order to do clarification, I have stated the both definition. Second definition is more general than first definition, and you, if we follow the second definition, then we have to use one more theorem. And I have also discussed the proof. Using this proof, you are able to understand that if I have somewhere if and only if condition is involved, then how to prove. So first you can assume that some condition is true, and after that you can land up to the result, and conversely you can do. So most of time, whenever necessary and sufficient condition is involved, then if and only if kind of statement is involved. Due to that reason, I have also discussed the proof of this theorem. Now let us come to some more discussion about the subspace. So one of the important fact I have already told you, that every subspace contain the zero vector, and if plane that do not contain the origin fails this test, this is obvious from this theorem, and basically those planes are not subspaces. So during the motivation part, what we have observed, that if I have three dimensional space, then any plane passing through origin is the example of the subspace. Similarly, line through the origin are also the subspaces. So another example is like this. So example is lines through the origin are also subspaces, and it is pretty easy to check why this is true, because it will satisfy the all property of the theorem. Now let us try to see some more example which is not the subspace. So I am going to talk about that example. So one obvious example is that if line will not pass through the origin, then that will not satisfy the definition of subspace, or in three-dimensional space basically I am talking about. Now suppose a two-dimensional plane, that is R2, so I have some vector space and this vector space, so I have x1 here and x2 here, so any point in this plane is the R2. Now keep only the vectors x1 and x2 whose components are positive. So basically I am going to consider the vectors in this quarter plane. So you can see that if I will take some vector, and suppose I am going to take vector like 2 and 3. Is included here, but suppose I have some vector like minus 2 and minus 3 that is not included here, so somehow whatever rule of theorem or whatever rule of definition, what we are telling, that we are telling that CV is in subspace, so C multiplied by 2 and 3, so I am going to represent like this, is in the subspace. Now you can substitute C equal to minus 1. So clearly this point is not inside the subspace, therefore I can conclude that the quarter plane is not a subspace. Now what we can do, also include those vectors whose components are both negative. Now I have two quarters plane, so let us draw it. So next example, you can write this as a next example. So I have again next example, so now I have two-dimensional plane. Again you can take x1 and x2. So now I am going to include these two parts. So I am going to include this part as well as this part. So now you can see that rule 2, whatever rule 2, so our rule 2 I have written like this. So what is our rule 2? That is C. C is coming from the field. CV is in the subspace. So if you can take any point in this plane, then there exists a C, either positive and negative, such that I will get some kind of point either in this side or this side. So this will satisfy the rule 2. So and origin is also included. So one can think that this is a subspace. But before going for the conclusion, please also check the rule 1. So what is our rule 1? Rule 1 is like this. So our rule 1 is, if I have two vectors in subspace, then their v plus w is in the subspace. So this is the rule 1. So now you can take two vectors. So I am going to take v equal to 2 and 3 and w equal to minus 3 and minus 2. So you can see that these two vectors are in the subspace. Now try to see that v plus w, that is minus 1 and 1. And basically this vector is outside the quarter planes. So two quarter planes do not make a subspace. So that is our conclusion, that two quarter planes do not make a subspace. So now I am going to write one generalization. So this as a remark. So remark is like this: a sub space containing v and w must contain all linear combinations CV plus TW where C and D are scalars. So directly one can check that something will satisfy the definition of vector space or not. Similarly, this is a story about the column spaces. Now let us try to see more example. So this example are related to the spaces which contain 2x2 matrix. So inside the vector space M of all 2x2 matrices here are 2 subspaces so basically first subspace I am going to denote by U that is all upper triangular matrices of the following form and second one I am going to denote by D all diagonal matrices U D. So diagonal matrix can be represented like this. So now you can see that if you add any 2 matrices or 2 upper triangular matrices, then sum is again upper triangular. Add any 2 diagonal matrix, again sum is diagonal. In this case, one can also see that D is also subspace of U. Of course, the zero matrix is in these subspace where all AB and D all equal to zero. Now, multiply the entity matrix also form a subspace. So you can take 2 into entity matrix plus 3 into entity matrix is again a subspace. And so 3 times 4i, that is the second requirement, that is again a entity matrix whenever A equal to D. So basically, the matrix C into entity form a line of matrices inside M and U and D. So one important point is appeared here that inside these two subspaces, so a remark in form of remark I am going to write. So remark is like that, D is also a subspace of U, and obviously these two matrices are the subspace of the matrix of the 2x2 matrix. In the next lecture, we are going to discuss some more part of the fundamental questions, whatever we have discussed in the today's class. So thank you very much.